All right. Hi, everyone. It's a great pleasure to welcome Sharon Johnston and Marklee this evening. I know many of you in the audience are big fans, so am I. And some of you have worked in their office, and I know many of you would love to. So if you want to talk to them at the end of the lecture, please come up. In many ways, this lecture follows on and echoes some of the sensibility that was shared through Moss's work last week with Hilary Sample's lecture. For one thing, there's what I think you've heard me say before, a definite generational sensibility or position in the work, and in reaction to much of the excesses and bravado of an earlier generation. At the same time, there's also a great concern for much of the inspiration and openness that an expanded notion of architecture has ushered in over the last couple of decades to make its way back into architecture as drawing, as building, and as physical experience. In the case of Johnston Marklee's work, an exquisitely beautiful and sensuous experience with much pleasure and play in its sequence, its layering and volumes, its forms, references, and its presence. The work is at once other and accessible, serious and with a certain lightness, and always greatly choreographed and controlled. Another generational mark, I think, is one we also touched upon last week with Hilary, that it can only be strangely paradoxical that in the midst of all of the architecture as global practice hype, which was all the buzz for many years now, Johnston Marklee is an incredibly embedded practice, embodying the deep cool, breeze, and ease of Los Angeles being. At the same time, they made a strong case for how they are defining Los Angeles in other ways and in some ways in opposition to the so-called LA school, or in their own words, that generation really strived for spectacle or excessiveness, but often at the cost of something else, Lee told me, as writes the journalist. It was almost a case of overpromising and under-delivering architecture that hogged itself to gain attention. Maybe historically it was good because it was an adrenaline shot for architecture, but in the long run it did more damage than good, talking about the previous generation. So talk about murdering their fathers is a very effective way to do it. From their Los Angeles roots and through the careful experimenting through the scale of the house, they've built a network of friends and collaborators from around the world whose interests and sensibilities they share and with whom they are in conversation. Many of them were included in curated commissions such as Orders 100 or the Solo Houses. I'm thinking here of Office, Peso von Enrichhausen, Su Fujimoto, Tatiana Baobao, and HSS from with whom they've collaborated. Johnston Marklee also offer us a less tense relationship to architecture, as serving great clients who are not thought of as such, but as collaborators with whom one can grow in a perpetually becoming mode, as Sharon puts it, and a mode one can enjoy. Last year, Johnston Marklee had what we call a breakout year, with the completion of the instantly iconic Vault House, the award of the prestigious Menil Drawing Institute, a new commission to alter the Art Institute in Chicago, and the Gran Traiano Art Complex in Italy, amongst other commissions. They're also part of the upcoming American Pavilion in Venice this summer. They have won too many awards to mention. Those they didn't win, they should have won, as we just decided. And are actively engaged in teaching at UCLA and often at the GSD. I'm trying to get them here also, so watch out. Both received their master from the GSD, actually. And so please join me in welcoming Sharon Johnston and Marklee. Welcome.
Thank you, Amale. I think the quote that Amale read that I made got us ostracized from the West Coast, so we have to escape to the East Coast. That's why we're here. And so we will teach for you for very little salary. Okay. So it's the first time we show our work in Colombia, so we're delighted to be here. We selected 10 projects to show you today from different times of our practice, some really early projects, and some that we just started. It hasn't really congealed yet, but I thought it could give an overview of a cross-section of our work and also an overview of some of the convictions or interests or ethos that we have been guiding our practice over the last, I think, 18 years. I think Sharon and I came of age in terms of architecture education at a time when everything is about boundary breaking. You know, everything is about blurring boundaries, dissolving boundaries. And I think to a certain point we were interested, we asked ourselves the questions like, is it valid to break boundaries? And what does architecture do best? And we realized for ourselves, architecture is at best building boundaries. You know, and I think by thinking of boundaries rather than escaping it, by thinking of building boundaries in a different way, maybe a different type of connectivity could be fostered or nurtured. Another thing that we're interested in is the typology. You know, I think for us, typology is something that we aspire to. Typology is not something that is handed down to us, that comes with a lot of rules in the Beaux-Arts sense that we had to follow. But typology for us is something that we see as something that accrued many intelligence and information over the years. And although we start each project with a very specific attention to its limitations or opportunities, as the project progresses, we always aspire to be part of type or to be part of a longer lineage in architecture history. So here are some examples of these images that a few years ago, Pinup magazine did a story, and they called this Johnston Marklee's alphabet. And we found the word alphabet quite interesting in the sense that it distills our projects down to the essence. And maybe it's just a silhouette with a series of punctures or apertures. So on this note, we'll start out with three single-family house projects. Single-family house is a typology that we have been working with. It's very typical of this Los Angeles context. And then we'll show four cultural institutions. And then we end up with three projects that are related to art museums. The first project that we're showing is designed maybe 15 years ago, finished 10 years ago. It's the Hill House. It's situated not far away from the Pacific Ocean and very close to the Eames House. It's not built on, it's a virgin lot, and one of the reasons it wasn't built on all these years is because the hillside ordinance, which tried to discourage overbuilding on hillsides in Los Angeles. So the upper two drawings are what you get from the city. All these restrictions made it financially unfeasible to build a house of that size, of 3,500 square feet, on that area. So we actually got the idea from Hugh Ferris in a way that he took the restraint as a design opportunity when he began to envision New York as this crystalline city. So step by step, we begin to three-dimensionalize the zoning, allowable zoning envelope, while with a desire to maximize the zoning, at the same time minimizing its footprint, because construction-wise, a lot of the cost goes into the foundation of the project. So in many ways, this project is designed from the outside in. After we finished the volume, we wanted to maintain this tension between a maximum volume and minimum footprint onto its apertures. So we try to maximize the size of the windows that are facing the views and minimizing the size of the windows that are facing its neighbors. So from the street, it looks like a very relatively small 1.5-story house. And then when you walk in, because we have maximized the buildable envelope, we couldn't extend any of the floors and the ceiling beyond the envelope. So it has a very different indoor-outdoor feeling as the mid-century case study houses that many people are familiar with. But I would say, I think 70% of the year, all these windows could open and it has this outdoor gazebo effect. The two walls, the lower walls, are actually perpendicular to the lot, so it works in tension, whereas the floor acts in tension to pull it back. So everything on the lowest floor is built out of concrete, and everything above is built out of steel. But none of the steel are visible, because now we have to deal with earthquake, and we have these really chunky steel members and cross members, and this house is 100 meters away from the Eames House, so if we expose the steel, this will look like a steel house on steroids. So you don't really get a sense this is a steel house, except for the fact that a lack of intermediary support, like the stair is actually hung from the beam itself, double height space, maybe a more warmer space on the mezzanine level. And it's undeniable, I think, it has some facial aspects to the house. And this is something I think we will never articulate ourselves, but I think there's something human about some of our buildings that we've always been interested in. I don't know what the expression is, but I think also this is a shot from an event where someone did a projection. I think for us, apertures are not just windows, but in many ways a form of projection. There's interesting side stories related to the house. We are so excited about this strategy after we did the massing. We did it for the entire block and showed it to the planning, Los Angeles Planning Department, but they were very unamused. The other thing was interesting was we did a, when we're designing the house, we did a, this collage. And when it was published because it won an award, and then someone said, well, you better show it to Julius Schulman, who is still alive, was 93 or 92. Otherwise, he could sue you for copyright infringement. And we actually showed it to Julius, and he was very generous, and he said, I won't sue you if I will come and photograph the house. So in many ways, he came, and he did a series of photographs. And I thought it was interesting for us because it was, we used this photograph as a means to, as a design tool, and then we see this kind of feedback loop when he came and he did a series of photographs, did a, I think 8 or 10 of them. Like this is his own chair, this Anne Jacobsen chair, and he spent a lot of time positioning it so that the curvature just receives the stairway, or bringing a lot of his props, some of his furniture, his own Harry Batoya sculpture, how he bring in a lot of artificial lighting, a lot of underlighting. So for us, it was a very interesting revelation after the building was built. The second house I'd like to show is a house in Rosario in Argentina, about a 3-hour drive up the river north of Buenos Aires. And it's situated in a relatively new development, and it's on a corner lot. When we started the project, there was nothing around us, but we know that in the future, 2 of the 4 sites will be occupied by houses. So when we started the design, it was like a glass house scenario. Everything is, there's nothing around you. But we know that 2 sites will be houses. So we preemptively think about the sequence, the circulation sequence of the house, as well as the apertures, so that it does not look into the future houses. It's a very simple spiral circulation. And the strategy was that every time you turn, there will be a window that frames the landscape in a different way. This is also the first time we built outside of the US, so we, not familiar with the construction culture there, we devised a very simple volumetric strategy, which is a primitive that is a marriage between a box and an ellipse. And then we just deployed 4 cuts, you know, 2 cuts that are straight cuts on a singular curved surfaces, and then 2 cuts that are fragments of a sphere, thinking that if they can build the formwork, concrete formwork for a sphere, they can easily build a fragment of that. So the apertures or the windows have a contiguous relationship with the cuts. So in a way, it's very much an object, and we try to have this synergy between the object from its exterior as well as this interior experience. So here you see an opening that's right next to a straight cut as well as right next to a fragment of a sphere. So this is behind the fragment of the sphere where a skylight will come in as a supplement light to the light that's coming in the window. So it's a spiral circulation, and then eventually you get up to the roof. I think in contrast to this heaviness or somehow this brute quality of the exterior, I think we always try to have a very light and open interior. Here you see how the windows are recessed, and it creates the formwork creates a shape, a shade. This is just a diagram of the unfolded circulation, how the cuts are always next to or adjacent to one of these openings. Here, perhaps you can see the cross-hatching relationship of the windows. Or how one of the cuts are used as a reflector for artificial light into the dining room. This building took so long, and as we were building it, other houses were already finished before us. And then you exit into this stairwell, and then you walk up, and then you see the entire Pampas, this whole panoramic landscape. when this house was finished, I think the best review we got was from a blogger who said this house looks like the love child between Mario Botta and a septic tank. But we actually see it as a big compliment, the Mario Botta part. And then the third house we'd like to show is the vault house. And this is the house, it's situated on the beach in Oxnard. It's a very typical beach situation in Southern California that extends from Malibu, Santa Barbara, all the way down to the South Bay. The houses, the lots are very long and narrow, and they're packed like sardines. And the problem with these houses is everyone tends to put the living room facing the beach and then the master bedroom right above, and which are great for those rooms, but then the rest of the house seems very dark and compressed, and oftentimes you have to walk between two houses in a narrow alley and enter the house in a very unceremonious way. So the first thing we wanted to do with our lot, which is open on one side, but we know in the future there will be a house there, so we designed it in anticipation, being sandwiched between two houses. But the first thing we did was we wanted to introduce a courtyard into the darkest place of the house to bring a lot of light in, as well as serves as an entry courtyard as means of spatial decompression. The second thing is we gave each room a shape, in this case a barrel vault that's all open. They're open on both ends and directed towards the beach. So this is the conceptual diagram with these vaults that are packed together like sardines again, but they don't overlap, and open on both sides and directed towards the ocean. Some earlier cross-sections, so we wanted every room to have a certain definition or defined boundary, but at the end, one room is always related to another. So sometimes you see a double height space, sometimes you see a very small single height space. The house itself is not axial, but it's, I would say there's a certain directionality. Each room is axial, but then as a collective, it has a certain direction. The goal for us is that even when you're at the end, near the end of the house, you still feel connected to the ocean from a point of view of view as well as air. Because the house is in this tsunami zone, so part of the house have to be raised in case a tsunami comes, the water could flow underneath. The houses as a collective doesn't form a dam. So we use the same type of vaulting system to elevate the house, and with a double height space and then a master bedroom and then the courtyard beyond. We work a lot with physical models, so we study a lot about the characteristics of the spaces in the physical model. When I show this project in Europe, my European colleagues are rolling their eyes because the house is not constructed out of concrete or rocks or stones or stereotomic construction. And I said, welcome to America. I think in a way we use the vault, but for us it's not never a tectonic device. You know, we always like see it as a spatial device that's directional. It's not so much about the historical illusion, but I think we always want a certain lightness to this house at the same time. But whether we want it to history or not, actually it worked very well contextually on the side that's facing the street because it works quite well with these Spanish colonial houses that's around. So it almost has this outerflow, so urban gill quality, in contrast to the side facing the beach, which is much more open and porous. We also decided to turn the clear story windows upside down. There were some comments that this looks like a sponge. I think we never like start off designing the house that this should look like a sponge, but we start off with these archetypes like vaults and arches, but as the project progresses, there are some decisions that come in, such as the clear story. How do you deal with the clear story? And for us, if we use a right side up vault, it would create a groin vault situation, which is okay, but it limits the amount of natural light that comes in. But turning it upside down actually opens up the Boolean cut between one shape and the other and brings more natural light in. So this was like shot right after it was finished. This is the beach side, the roadside, and one walks to the center of the house. We also use the vault as a mean of cutting up the house and opening it up more and widening the path. And you walk up the stairs and to a courtyard. So on one side, you're facing with the library and the gym. And then on the opposite side, you walk through the dining room, kitchen, living room. This is a sculpture, so it's not
Not our client.
Not a client, not to scale, yeah. And looking back, you can see the master bedroom actually that opens, looks through the double height space into to the ocean as well as opening to the courtyard. By the way, these are like two glass fish sculptures that were salvaged from Frank Gehry's Rebecca's restaurant from 1986. I think you can see this is like a right side of vault, and here we use the right side of vault also to bring natural light from the roof down to the porch. So this is the view from the master. And then this is the view where your back is facing the two rooms facing the street. So you're almost at the edge of the house, but you can still see the connection to the ocean. I think here would be an example of how the upside down vault, clear story, brings more natural light into the right side up vault. And then a series of skylights in between. So in terms of lightness, I think basically everything is constructed out of concrete. Everything above is steel, but the pochet allow us to have cross bracing for the steel as opposed to moment connection. And then furthermore, all the HVACs are in the pochet space.
Great, thanks. So I think Amale even touched on this a little bit, but a key part of our practice on research and design development in all of our projects is always somehow expanding the conversation outside of our discipline as a way to sort of look back at what we're doing and continually to sort of critique and think more deeply about our work. And that's included a kind of long-standing collaboration with a group of artists that have become good friends and we've invited into the development of our work. So these images are a portfolio of a collection of work. This is a part of a series we did with Jack Pearson of the Vault House. These are part of a portfolio of our good friend Louisa Lambry, who may be here tonight, that she, her photographs of the Hill House in Santa Monica, looking very carefully at texture and qualities of light, sort of turning this massive building into a sort of very ephemeral series of fragmented views. Or Jim Welling of the Porch House, where really focusing on the aperture within this very sort of heavy cast-in-place concrete house as a way to sort of understand and project light within this massive structure. And also our good old friend Livia Corona, who I think is in Mexico right now, but she was one of the first artists that we invited into this kind of conversation. This suite of images is called House for Sale, where we'd finished a project and the owners hadn't yet occupied it, and so she took the sort of narrative of the potential dwellers of the house, coupled with her fascination at that time in gerontology, and created a series of images that captured, or sort of developed, inspired by the mathematical rhythms that are in this house, which is an addition to the 2468 studio by Morphosis. And then also a Swiss photographer, Marianne Mueller, who traveled to Los Angeles and typically works in diptychs, so kind of combining two images of our work, kind of situated within the context of Los Angeles, the sort of everydayness of LA. And these works, along with a host of other artists' portfolios, are part of a forthcoming book that will be out this spring. That was designed and edited by Rachel Geiser, a professor at Rice University. And instead of, as a kind of maybe an alternative to a monograph, the book is made up of a series of the artist's work, a series of conversations with friends, Sylvia Levin, Sarah Whiting, Philip Ushbrung, art historian from the ETH in Zurich, and Veronica Kellendorfer, another artist who also photographed the Hill House, as well as a suite of drawings, Wally Beshti doing a sort of comic strip-like story of a number of the houses in conversation with one another. And so we look forward to sharing this book with you in a couple of months. So as Mark mentioned, this series is kind of beginning to expand beyond the single family house, starting with actually probably the smallest and project of shortest duration in our office, but it somehow captures the DNA of how we work, which is a small library for a couple in Michigan. It was never built. We worked on it for a couple of weeks. But the brief was very simple, sort of one view to a vertical canyon and another towards a horizontal little lake. And so we simply tried to find the most direct means to solve that problem, one vertical window, one horizontal. and then inscribed one arc in plan that connected those two windows, and then multiplied that arc as the sort of enclosure of the house. So in plan and elevation, the house sort of has a sort of, it's impossible to differentiate its orientation. And with those silhouettes, then simply the surfaces between them become sort of the result of that profile. So that kind of directness has inspired the work as we've begun to work on maybe perhaps more complex sites or more extensive programmatic briefs. So this is a collection, our contribution to a collection of projects in Chile. It's called Chile House. It was part of the reconstruction effort after the 2010 earthquake in the Biobío region. So our site is in Penco along the coast. And so the brief was basically to make about a 3,000 square foot center, which would be a kind of community space that could be used for anything that that particular locale needed, and then would eventually become an art space. And so our work was really to somehow embrace the sort of great view of the bay, envelop it into a figure that was the interior space of the hall, but then double that space as an exterior space, a sort of prelude to entering the hall in a way, a sort of commemorative kind of open and undefined space. So that entry courtyard is oriented towards the sky in a vertical way, and then the interior hall is oriented horizontally back out to the bay. So these two self-similar forms are then inscribed within a very kind of discrete enclosure that defines the envelope of the building. And at the point of tangency is the point of entry. So there's one sort of moment of diagonal view that continues through the entire building. And then in the interstitial space is the service program that supports this will now be is adopted by a dance group. So here's that moment of entering on the corner of the courtyard, and then that diagonal view through, and then the opposing view from the bay. So when you approach the building, it's really a building that's defined in plan. It almost has sort of no sort of formal articulation, almost like a bunker. It almost hides itself, except for this one moment when you approach and have that kind of glimpse through both figures. The courtyard, it really masks out the middle ground, the horizon. It's about the sky and the ground. And that space is animated by the way light plays in the courtyard, and the texture of the walls, which are proposed to be cast. We have to remove just a couple trees from that forest, so that we're making molds of those trunks, and that forms a sort of rough scallop shape of the molds for the cast-in-place concrete. And then in the same way that we're sort of doubling that those two plan shapes, the idea for the interior of the interior space is to once again mirror that sort of sweep of the bay inside the space of the hall, just to sort of totally surround you, sort of projecting that behind you through the reflective quality of the wall. So it's cast-in-place concrete that's just kind of hand-rubbed until it just has a slight luster, and so that horizon line will sweep all the way behind you with a view in front. And soon after that, the design of that project was completed, we were invited to participate in the Shanghai West Bund Biennial, which was a series of pavilions along the Bund in Shanghai. And our site was seemed to be highly problematic because it was in the middle of a sort of strange triangle in an area which is now probably has about 10,000 units of housing around it. David Chipperfield's museum is probably just about finished right here. So it was really a site in transition and a site with many different sides. And so given that we knew the program would change pretty radically over the course of the life of this little building, we conceived of it, we call it the Pavilion of Six Views, which is six kind of similar shapes, three oriented inward and three oriented outwards towards the city. So the building has a kind of loose coherence that feels sometimes as one building and oftentimes sort of dissolving into a series of smaller buildings. And I think that our interests, Mark talked about type and the idea of sort of approximation, that for us, this site is a space, is a landscape that is in rapid transformation. And so we wanted to think about the building sort of approximating these large scale industrial halls, some of which will remain, but also having a kind of looseness and an intimacy that would respond to the cultural programs of galleries and other kinds of kind of pop-up events that would happen over the course of the biennial and to today. So it sits on this triangular lot with some of the pavilions like this, with the sort of picture window, and always entering in the space between the two pavilions. Inside, there's always two sources of light that sort of balance out the space from the horizontal window, and at the kind of pinch point of each one of those pavilions is another skylight. And this sort of dual quality of individual pavilions in a collective space allows for very different curatorial practices. So this is the inward pavilions that create a more continuous space versus the other three, which are sort of more individual in their definition. More recently, the building about a year and a half ago was adopted by the Shanghai Center for Photography, and so it has yet another life, which has been sort of fascinating to see how it subtly transformed to accommodate photography. So it feels at sometimes quite small and minimal in its footprint, and at other moments from other perspectives, it sort of unfolds into a much bigger building. This is a project finally home in their back home in Los Angeles, where we won several years ago that we're just starting up again because we've been able to raise, the UCLA has been able to raise the funds. It's for the graduate art studios, and it's off-site in a place called the Hayden Tract. So it's a sort of pretty well-known industrial area in Los Angeles. And UCLA has owned this property for, you know, almost 25 years. It's a loose kind of agglomeration of some kind of beautiful warehouse and a series of other sort of not so well functioning kind of commercial buildings. And so essentially what our initial analysis was to sort of distill this kind of cacophony of sort of ill-used buildings and sort of purge all of that. So we end up with one sort of the DNA of this great well-proportioned warehouse, a continuous ground, a new perimeter, which really in a way just sort of duplicates and expands the facade of the existing warehouse. And then as well expanding the buttress roof of the existing warehouse to form a sort of continuous roof landscape for the new building. And it's defined, of course, with studios and classroom spaces, all of which are organized around these sort of underdefined loose programs like circulation spaces, pin-up spaces, gardens, things that become part of the public life, almost like the building as a city is how we conceived of it. So here is the sort of proposal without the roof, so this sort of loose indoor-outdoor spaces around the perimeter surrounding the existing warehouse. And then a translucent roof that shelters indoor-outdoor space that connects and unites the addition with the existing building. So just simply by subtly transforming this very vernacular language of the warehouse, we began to create a sort of almost institutional definition for the school that sort of takes on the structure and inhabits it through classrooms and the way that structure sort of in a new structure integrates with existing and new and the new roof structure so that it becomes much more of a landscape of inhabitable structure, maybe in contrast to the existing sort of definition of roof and volume. So that sort of generic quality of the existing building is maintained, but just punctuated and punctured a little bit, so it starts to become more porous to the city. And this series just looks through some of the public collective spaces, the garden, which was really a mandate that the students wanted as a place for work, pin-up spaces that are part of a neighborhood of studios, indoor-outdoor workshops that are now adjacent to the street, so materials come in and out in a really easy way. And altogether, that simply the roof sort of becomes the sort of quiet identity for the building that holds all of those different volumes together. This is a recent project we just won, and it was a competition at the University of Chicago, and it's called the Green Line Art Center, so it's a new performing arts building. And it's the university is just a little bit to the south and across the park, and what is kind of interesting for us about this project is that this is our building, but it will eventually be part of a much larger block, a kind of arts block. And part of one of the clients is at the University of Chicago is Theaster Gates, who's already begun to renovate some of these buildings. And so here is our site right next to the Green Line. So it's a super loud building. It's very incredibly loud. L train passes by every 10 minutes. But in any case, we had to restore this facade and then insert a new warehouse that would accommodate different two well-tuned performing a black box theater and a movie theater, as well as a number of workshops and studio spaces. And so sort of fitting in with that context, but somehow suggesting the larger scale of this new, more institutional and civic scale to this community dance hall. And so we were looking for a kind of language for the building that would both accommodate this flexible, almost industrial scale of the building, but also echo the sort of intimacy of the domestic landscape that it's situated around and will that it will support in terms of its programming. And so here, the sort of module or the sort of repetition of the structure allows us the flexibility to create two very sort of highly tuned performing arts volumes, the Black Box and the theater, and then these two sort of buffer spaces, winter gardens that allow for really flexible space. Or alternatively, when these doors are open, this can become one continuous 7,000 square foot space. So flexibility was sort of the main mandate, and then how that kind of light and atmosphere could, with the most minimal means, kind of define those spaces. And we see this building as part of a larger landscape of a much bigger context of buildings, projects that the Astro has been involved in, and these kinds of programs that are not perhaps as finely tuned to spaces like we're sitting in, but still accommodate a lot of really creative practices. So here we began to introduce a new scale to the building, a new level of transparency, while at the same time sort of muting out and blocking in some of the existing windows to sort of shift the scale relative to the adjacent buildings. I think another key part of this fabric, which is incredibly depressed economically and in terms of opportunity, was to think about a kind of reciprocity between the front and the back. So it becomes a kind of continuous space and sort of denies those typical hierarchies that you would see in urban landscapes. And then inside the building, the layering of the finely tuned theater and Black Box coexists kind of quite nicely with these more flexible rehearsal spaces or community spaces in between. So that they can sort of, the building sort of tunes itself to the needs of a high sort of performing dance troupe or more kind of everyday community activity. And I think that also I would say another sort of impetus for the formal language of the project is the idea that somehow this project and the language of the architectural structural language of the building can proliferate and begin to support a much larger set of workshops and more flexible spaces than the rest of the block. So just beginning to speculate on how that might work as a kind of collective fabric.
This is the very first collage we did that I showed earlier, and of course this collage I think helped us figure out the importance of this continuity of the edge. Yeah, but I, on the other hand, I think you know, this is such a well-known image of Julia Schumann's, and it suddenly became the icon of post-war living in Southern California. And sometimes we ask, like, how much did architecture play a role within this icon? Like, can one take away the foreground where the jacuzzi is? Can one take away the canopy and reduce the whole essence of the photograph to this corner window condition in relationship to a distant lot? So I think after this, we begin to do other. We did a first series was the Schumann series. This one was for the Sail House, where we're interested in this kind of infinite depth together with this complete flatness. And then we were obsessed with doing these. And you might ask why, but I think I remember David Lee Roth, when he was with the Van Halen, said, was interviewed about what he wanted to achieve with an album. He said, I want the album to be so hot that afterwards you can put it on your shelf and it burns all the other albums next to it. Not that we have that ambition, but I think no matter what, I think one tends to measure oneself up against history. And I think for us, in many ways, these collages or montages are in one way expedient design solutions or ways to distill the project down to a certain essence, but in a way also think about them in relationship to history, which I have to give a shout out to a student here, Greta Groebelich, who did many of these collages for the Chicago Biennial. And I think history is something that we have always have this a strange relationship with. You know, we don't like typology. We don't feel our hands being tied by history or being suppressed by history. But history as a fountain of wealth of ideas that we constantly mine from. I think always we always say, like, if we could situate ourselves within history, I think we like to be between the two Aldos, either Aldo Rossi and Aldo Van Eyck. We'll be very happy. You know, I think for us, these are two figures that that brought back history in modern architecture, albeit in very different situations and with very different solutions. One is like through understanding of the object as the urban artifact, the proliferation of these objects transcends scale. And then the other is really thinking of a very humanistic way of healing or engaging the post-war European city. And I stress city as a scale that we're interested in as opposed to this metropolitan scale. So after the series of architectural photographies, there's a series of images from Italian film. This one is a black series, yeah. And this one, I have to say, is in a very prominent collection that we are very proud of. And so there are these recurring themes of Mies, of Ellsworth Kelly, of Super Studio that become the source of a lot of our collages that was shown together with the artist's photographs at the biennial. And talking about like dealing with history, I think it sometimes also happens in our work. I mean, Los Angeles is not a place rich with history, but I think often there are opportunities that we had to deal with history. In this case, this is an early 1934 project by Richard Neutra, the Sten Femke House. It was an early photograph when nothing was around, and we were commissioned to build an accessory building. We're fascinated by this period of Neutra. 1934, very early on, before he developed his signature spider-lit column or the corner window, came out from Mendelssohn's office. The motif of this semicircular porch was in two of his projects, and we basically tried to think of another version of this porch that begins to almost proliferating from the main building, although semicircular but somehow truncated, in a way that relates to that part of that lineage of history. And as Sharon mentioned earlier, there's another house. This is one of the first houses by Morphosis, the 2468 house, where we had to rebuild the main house that was burned down by fire, but we went back into the archives of Morphosis and found this axonometric drawing where Tom and Michael wanted to proliferate the house, rotate it in the same way they rotate the windows. So we used that as a device to create something, not mimicry, but in a way take the same type of proportions to recreate the backdrop or the anonymity of the existing house in relationship to the 2468 studio, but at the same time using the same type of dimensions, the 4x4, 6x6, 8x8 windows, and the 20x20 massing. So in a way, these type of projects of responding to historical projects, in a way, maybe encapsulates how we treat these last three projects that we're going to show you. This one is, I'm going to show you very quickly because this is one we just started. It's the Museum of Contemporary Art in Los Angeles. And those who've been to LA, this is a project finished in 1986 by Arata Isosaki, a year after he finished the Palladium Club down on, I think, on 14th. But I would say at that time, Isosaki was at the height of his career. A lot of the motifs of this Euclidean geometry of the cylinder, the pyramid, the cubes were there, the use of the Indian red sandstone in relationship, in reference to Fatehpur Sikri, it became an important museum, both architecturally and programmatically. These are Isosaki's own drawings. You see the two curvature he mentioned as Marilyn Monroe's profile, to his early silk screens that for us has this type of forlorn quality, almost Giorgio di Chirico. I don't know how it compares with Rossi, but it has this kind of vibrant colors, but have this type of long shadows. Huh? That was the beginning. You know, I also want to show it in context with artists like Klaus Oldenburg or Barbara Kasten. But this is the photograph of MoCA when it was built. It was really like a ship on a dry dock with nothing, no context around to speak of. Although Isosaki knew that there would be a context. But the context has changed dramatically 30 years later. Like this was what it was when it was built, and this is what it was now, what it is now, today. With the finish of the broad, Dils Cofidio Renfro's broad, basically the last missing tooth on the site is finished. So in a way, the urban situation of Grand Avenue is completed. So in contrast to Arthur Erickson's original plan, a lot has changed in terms of new cultural facilities or institutions that were brought in as opposed to the retail that was originally envisioned. So how do you deal with MoCA today? How do you deal with it in this kind of situation in relationship to the cultural institutes like Disney Concert Hall, Hardy Holtzman Pfeiffer's Colburn Music Center, and the Broad across the street? So this is what it was before envisioned. This is pretty much what it is now. Over time, it has accrued a lot of barnacles. You know, there was a canopy that was added on later. The plaza has lost its sense of place, you know, because it's connected to the California Plaza. No one knows how to get into MoCA. No one knows you have arrived into the museum. So What we propose is in two phases. The first phase is very, in a way, a very invisible way of subtraction and very, very subtle additions. The subtraction includes the taking away of the canopy, adding a wall, and really delimit the edge of the plaza. So you know that you're in the plaza, you're in Mocha. It really creates this type of space, whether you're coming from the plaza or coming from the street. The other is to clean up this whole area of ticketing. There was a cube where the ticket booth is. We propose to remove it, put the ticketing down to downstairs where the galleries are, and create and clutter the space where one enters through this porch. And then the last thing is to, from the exterior, is to take the cafe where the Marilyn Monroe curve is, expand it and accommodate a bookstore. Furthermore, in the interior, we open up this ticketing space to create a more visual nexus between all the galleries at the entry. So this is how the cacophony of circulation is today, and how we think by having these slight moves would drastically change it and create orientation within the museum. This is what it is now. You can see the cafe, the hotel, and the fountain that's not part of the museum, and how it will be with a new wall that carries the same detail of Isosaki's and close it off with a series of canopies, but define the sculpture courtyard. The entry with the cube, the ticketing cube, and how it would be without that with a handicap ramp. So in a way, create this type of more enclosed area that somehow for us begins to bring back the essence of Isosaki's project before the new context encroached. Or the cafe now, and how it would become a bookstore. The space, the lower courtyard before you enter into the museum, and the ticketing area, which takes up a lot of room, but we propose to open it up so one is connected to the stair that takes one down to the theater below. And opening a much more generous opening for a clearer direction for one to enter the galleries. So it's really a series. These are the subtractions. These are the additions. And this is the first phase. The second phase we're studying right now is how we can add more galleries. So right after this central courtyard space is for us rectified, how do we add more gallery spaces? So here is the end of the first phase, and then these are what we're proposing and studying right now. And we're trying to preserve this type of agglomeration of volumes that Isosaki had in terms of this multiple profiles of the buildings in contrast to the high-rises around.
So this is a project we've been working on for about a year and a half in Chicago for the MCA in Chicago. And the MCA is a building completed in 1996 by Joseph Paul Kleihus, and it sits in a park landscape, Seneca Park and Lakeshore Park, and continues out to the lake. So it's really, that's the sort of legacy of great museums in Chicago, is the museum and the park. But it, unlike all the other parks, which are quite expansive, this is really sort of a park, like a canyon-like urban space, which is surrounded by towers. And on top of that, the sort of solidity of the Kleihus building makes that, it really sort of sits in that landscape much more like a sort of dam or a block than something that can facilitate the continuity of the city out to the lake. So I think it's, in a way, a sort of important building in Kleihus's career, but challenged by a lot of circumstances to do with budgets and so forth as the building evolved. Probably the most defining quality about the building is that it's based on a grid. It's a really strict 13 by 13 foot grid that really regulates everything about the building. And so it's incredibly rigid. This is the west facade, and this is the east facade. And I think both the structure, the glazing, the apertures, the sort of organization of the building into the base and the mass above are all guided by this grid. And so I think what happens is that it sits in a very sort of off-putting way to the street. It's very tight to the sidewalks. This plaza is pretty unforgiving. The primary entry to the building is through this monumental stair. And then on the back, sort of equally difficult problems with a series of sort of misguided terraces and ramps that really disconnect the building from the surrounding park. Some of the best qualities about the building are the fourth floor galleries. These barrel vaulted galleries form about 12,000 square foot of continuous space, so it's a place that has pretty important shows across the US, as well as these ascendant artist galleries. So those are unified or kind of connected by this multi-story atrium, which has supported some really important site-specific works by artists, as well as this ship-shaped stair that was somehow a sort of legacy of Kleihue's, his larger body of work and important to this building. On the other hand, there's a lot of spaces that are really overscaled and always feel very empty, and I think that was sort of the main critique of this building, that it feels very big, but it offers very little in terms of program. And so, but alternatively, on the exterior, it really, there's something quite powerful about this front facade that really acts like a stage for artists to do interventions and sort of really signals what's happening inside. But other than that, it's not a very well-loved building. So we were commissioned to think about it at the scale of a master plan, so imagining the future and a possible addition as well as an interior renovation. And really for us, what was important is to try to think about how this building can become more literally connected to the city through program, through transparency, through any means we could to sort of create that connectivity, both thinking about the base, the podium that sort of separates the museum, and then also thinking inside about how circulation and kind of continuity between public space and galleries can be more fluid. So if this is the kind of backtracking and single points of entry that exist today, this is part of the first phase of renovation where there's a new restaurant, it's adjacent to the theater, there's new, more circulation, so it becomes what we call kind of a street that connects from the exterior all the way through and up into the other public spaces in the museum. This is how it looks today, and this is how it will look in the near future, with new program, opening it up, adding a new stair, sort of making it much more contiguous with life of the street. And then circulation is a real problem in the museum, a lot of backtracking, so we open up with new stairs in this corner and a new stair here, so the sort of promised but not delivered symmetry that creates more fluidity in the building will be hopefully eventually part of the building. And as well in the section, this is the sort of overscaled entry spaces here and here with this pretty great atrium. So by introducing two new floors, we create a much more varied landscape and a more intimate space to enter and exit through the museum. And so those new floors sort of improve conditions like this, which are really frustrating and sort of totally not functioning. So two new bridges that connect the new circulation on either side, and then a new space for education on the east side of the building. So if this is how these spaces exist today, we're proposing to introduce a new floor that adds about 3,000 square feet on either side. And we had the chance this last fall to kind of test drive this installation. You don't get the chance to do a one-to-one installation very often, but this is one of our projects for the biennial, where we sort of built a space frame grid that sort of approximates the new scale of our intervention, and also helped us sort of really examine some of those kind of strange and peculiar idiosyncrasies of the grid of Kleihue's that at one point near the end of construction documents had to shrink from 13 feet to 11 feet. So it has this a lot of sort of strange gaps and misalignments that were fascinating to us. So existing condition, transformation, and addition. So the first phase of the project is about 20,000 square feet of new program. And then finally on the fourth floor, we'll add a new stair and create more gallery space as part of the master plan. So this new lower level street is sort of super active with program and a new kind of architectural language of the vault. It will have a new restaurant and other sort of artist interventions that will sort of link the ground floor with the upper spaces. All the perimeter spaces, this is a new sort of library slash engagement space, which is on the east side of the building, create a new sort of porous public edge, and then the new third floor, which is also a more public kind of education space. And then looking back, sort of zooming out to the master plan, Mark talked a bit at the beginning about the notion of boundaries. And for us, part of the way we imagine making this building more connected to the city is actually to define the edge in a more deliberate way. And so we propose to introduce new program volumes, which will be imagined as galleries, almost storefront galleries, that also sort of mitigate the massive monumental scale of this stair. So here it is, the museum today. The first part of that transformation, bringing more transparency to the base, and then introducing these storefront galleries and sort of space for a patio and above that for more outdoor art outside the museum. As well, we looked at the back of the building. I think there's a real aspiration eventually to create a total continuity between the lake, the Michigan Avenue, through the museum. So looking at how to mitigate this sort of really jumbled up series of plazas and circulation areas that exist today by transforming it into just two simple terraces, and the stair almost becomes like a stage. They have a lot of activities in that area, and so really trying to think about it as a kind of room in the city, as opposed to the sort of way it's bifurcated now. And then finally looking at how we could bring more gallery space to the building. But we felt, given the sort of the power in a way, whether you like it or not, of that grid, to somehow work within that module, but create another kind of scale and volumetric quality to the campus or to the building site by working kind of within that language. So two new pavilions and then an open space, a kind of large-scale winter garden that's continuous with the park. So the galleries are continuous across the floors, and then the atriums also become part of a continuous landscape that would be a space for art as well as a garden. So here's the proposed new west facade, and then the east facade, looking also at a kind of, in contrast to the dullness and sort of weight of the MCA today, working with a sort of slightly billowing aluminum sheet material that gives it a kind of luminosity that is, in a way, kind of contrasts with the existing building. And so much more gallery space, and then kind of thinking about how this becomes the new heart of the building. It's between a park, a garden, and a space for art. So then finally looking at how the park would be transformed by this addition, and through simple transformations of program, we could create a much more open space that sort of begins to approximate the scale, or at least the kind of public nature of a lot of the other museums in the park in Chicago, which is really what defines the civic landscape of the city. And the last project we wanted to share with you is our design for the Manil Drawing Institute in Houston. And this project, maybe many of you have been to Houston, but it's a pretty sublime landscape for art in Houston. It is comprised of about 30 acres that this is the kind of site when we won the competition. This is the Manil collection from Renzo Piano from the late 80s. This is the Byzantine Chapel. This is Byzantine, this is the Rothko Chapel, this is the Flavin Building, and this is the Twombly Pavilion. And this was a big housing block that was, up until today, has been a big income generator for the Manil. So this project generated a lot of transformation, which we'll just talk a little bit about. So these are these kind of exquisite but somehow imperfect buildings that make up the Manil campus, the Rothko Chapel, the Manil collection from 87 of Renzo, his great first American building, the Twombly Pavilion, which was about 10 years later in 1997, the Byzantine Chapel by François de Manil, a really great, beautiful building that's recently transformed its program. And then the Flavin Building, also from around the late 90s. And I think what, the campus, it's not really a campus, but somehow all the buildings sort of hold together under the sort of umbrella of the mothership of the Manil Collection Building. And each one of the buildings at the Manil, the Manil campus is really known for top-lit galleries that are all somehow, they're quite different, but really set a new standard for lighting in museums at the time and really still today. And equally important to the buildings is the outdoor spaces and the outdoor art that is carefully curated and inscribed into the landscape, as well as these pre-war bungalows that are, many of which are owned by the Manil, and simply by painting them a coat of gray paint become part of a more coherent fabric that gives a kind of intimacy and almost a domesticity to the kind of scale of the larger museum buildings. And then, of course, finally, the trees are really a vital part of the fabric of this place. I think what, when we first started thinking about the project, what was so kind of special and something we wanted to really try to understand and manage was this kind of meandering quality, this kind of sense of being in between. It's never, the buildings, despite being quite large, never feel monumental. A lot of that is the way they're situated in relationship to these houses in the way that you move through the campus. But probably the real sort of DNA of everything that's happened in Houston is this building of Philip Johnson's, really his first public commission from the early 50s, which is the Manil House. And the Manils were really incredible and incredibly strong clients. And this project really formed the DNA for the Manil Collection Building that Renzo completed, and of course was really important to us given the intimate scale of the building. But I think what's probably important to say now is just the importance of the garden. The Manils had traveled quite a lot, and this almost tropical scale or feeling and atmosphere of that courtyard is something that defines the house. And so for us, our building, the Drawing Institute, is about 30,000 square feet, so a relatively small museum building. We really imagine it as something between the scale of the house and the museum. So it sort of defines a new scale for institutional architecture at the Manil. And we knew that given the sort of legacy of the courtyard from the house and from the Manil collection building, that somehow the garden needed to really define and help us organize the Drawing Institute. So the Manils built their house in the 50s, and a lot of their sort of art patronage was in collaboration with Rice and also St. Thomas. So this is Philip Johnson's campus for St. Thomas that was largely funded by the Manils. And also in this picture is the chapel, which is, I'm sort of disoriented. But
the white one, yeah.
Here. And so this is now the site where the Manil Collection Building was eventually built. So it was initially a really a residential fabric. And they first commissioned Lou Kahn to begin to look at the possibility of designing a museum. And the idea that's developed before that project was halted was the idea of how art storage could really be an idea that there would be less hierarchy between storage and art exhibition. And through just the fate of history, almost simultaneously or within a year, John de Manil died and Louis Kahn died. So this project kind of sat dormant for about 10 years. But somehow was important both for Renzo's research and sort of defining the kind of vision of what the campus would eventually be. And there were other important architects along the way. This was a commission of Louis Barragán for a kind of an artist-in-residence building that was, again, defined by a courtyard, but eventually never built because I guess Dominique felt it was way too big. And Barragán would never relent on the scale and proportion of the building, so it was never completed. So this is the campus before David Chipperfield began his master plan. So this drawing really captures Chipperfield's master plan, what we were given when we started. He completed that, and then there was a competition for the Drawing Institute. So just for quick orientation, this is the Manil Collection. So the dark buildings are the Manil buildings. And then the proposed new buildings are these buildings in light gray. These are the new residential towers that replace the big apartment building. And that's the Drawing Institute that sits about in the middle of the campus. So the trees are, of course, a really important part of the fabric of this campus. This was our site. These were trees that were part of that big apartment and ones that Dominique had actually planted. And so our first move was a very direct approach, which was to just make rooms around those trees. We knew we wanted to bring the garden into the Drawing Institute and use the kind of canopy of the trees as part of the sort of atmosphere and quality of light. And then the building sort of fills in the space around those courtyards and sort of nests up around this necklace of residential buildings that are part of that historic fabric. And then on the inside of the building, the idea that these relatively small rooms that are rooms for exhibition and drawings, study of drawings, almost approximate the fabric of the surrounding bungalows, all of which are sort of inscribed within this unifying roof that shelters the buildings and creates a halo of shade around the building. We've been working with Guy Nortenson and his team based here in New York on the structure of the project, and I think that it's been sort of a long journey, but the final sort of resolution of these structures is a sort of very thin steel plate. They're half-inch steel plate canopies that are sort of suspended and cantilevered off of steel plate walls. So they're both very thin but very heavy, and that's something that sort of defines, those contrasting qualities kind of define the building in many different instances. So conceptually, it's the idea of a sort of thin sheet of paper almost that's suspended over the building and out into the landscape that nests underneath the trees to create this sort of extended landscape. So this is the existing site as it was before we started construction. And at the completion of phase one, this will be the Drawing Institute here, a new garden. We're working with Michael van Valkenburg on the landscape for the Drawing Institute. And then we're also doing a new energy plant. So we're replacing a building that was here and moving it over, so creating a new space. And then Michael's doing a new garden to the south. I think as we talked about, we were always sort of fascinated by how you move through the campus. It really sort of makes defines the atmosphere. So circulation was kind of where we started, where you could almost pass through the building and never enter it through this very sort of non-monumental, sort of off-axis landscape of paths. The building itself is a very simple massing of three volumes for art exhibition, administration, and study and curatorial conservation work. And all of those three volumes are enclosed by these roofs and then defined by three garden courtyards. Light is a really key part of the kind of success of this building, and perhaps in contrast to the other buildings at the Manil, which have top-lit galleries, that really wasn't an option for us. So there was sort of the added pressure of not only working next to Renzo and this kind of beloved campus, but also trying to define a new strategy for light in these buildings. And so this was an early study looking at how we could use the architecture and the landscape to move from this 10,000-foot candle Texas light into the galleries, which are 5-foot candles. And we're able to do that simply by extending the roof, using the trees, and then just expanding that journey so that you never end up with that sort of matinee effect. So with sort of very elemental means, satisfying a really serious kind of technological problem of the project. So from the south to the park, Michael's New Park, the building has a sort of very mute quality to it. It simply almost feels like a porch in the landscape. As you get closer to the building, moving north, it defines a new sort of intermediate scale garden that finally we'll be able to see the south facade of Twombly. Michael's designed a new sort of really intimate garden. There'll be films and things that are happening on the new energy house here. And then the courtyard, the west courtyard of the Drawing Institute, really our idea for it was sort of a garden within the larger room, a room within the campus that's an outdoor room that's a sort of intermediate space. It's more intimate, and it brings the kind of shadow of the trees and the canopy, introduce you to a new scale and a new light level. So this is the east courtyard, similarly proportioned, but with a more verdant, almost domestic garden, with a sort of view, diagonal view, into the third courtyard, which we call the scholar courtyard. The living room is where all the public circulation comes together in one space, so we eliminate a lot of extra circulation, and it is the kind of link between the public and private parts of the building, where that module of the roof canopy now comes together in a pitch that forms a kind of familiar figure in that residential landscape. The galleries are tuned for drawing, so they're intermediate scaled, and then opposite the galleries is the scholar courtyard, which is another kind of garden and a more intimate space for scholars and administration. The drawing room is really the center and heart of the building. It has a series of kind of special systems for modulating natural light, and it works in conjunction with the conservation library and the conservation lab. So these are sort of the innermost spaces of the building that are removed from the landscape but filled with natural light. So the building sort of sits in that campus. It's both has presence, but in a way almost falls back into the scale of residential buildings. It sort of changes its profile as you move around it, finally in this view from the west, where it actually almost feels at the scale of the domestic houses and the transparency of the living room, which unites the two public and private sides of the building. So just, I think, to conclude, I think that we always were always testing the scale of the Drawing Institute between the scale of the Manil collection building and the other pavilions on the campus, and it sits somewhere in between the single artist pavilions and the main museum in plan and also in section. But I think the section really captures this idea of the sort of elongated profile that makes the building feel sort of much bigger on the outside than it does on the inside. And I think this final image captures perhaps something, I mean, it's certainly qualities about the Drawing Institute that really define it as a kind of in-between condition between inside and outside sort of building and landscape, but perhaps gets at some of the other qualities that we talked about throughout the lecture about the importance of history, the idea of the sort of approximating, moving towards typology, but not sort of starting with type. So it has that sort of in-betweenness is something that we aspire to in all of our work, I think, is captured here in this sort of final image of our building, which is under construction. It'll finish, I think the first show is in September of 17. So. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. So, are you so
oh, yes. This is where I'm like, don't go. Well, thank you. Thank you both for a wonderful lecture. You started with this notion of reinstating boundaries and the kind of importance of boundaries. And I think it's really sort of interesting to think about the work as, especially the early work, as kind of reinstating the boundary, but then there's a sense of constantly sort of eroding it, perforating it, pushing it, moving it, and kind of undermining it kind of architecturally. Framing it and then sort of undoing the frame. And in particular, the kind of constant perforation is really interesting. And I never thought about how much the work was contextual, and these kinds of framing of the landscape, which is obviously very, if you think about, the practice starting really with the houses and the kind of case study houses in LA, but then you kind of shy away from the lightness that the case study houses wanted to bring in and create a kind of new kind of transparency and engagement with the landscape, which is sort of really interesting. It's kind of between mass and surface. And I think that what's really kind of interesting in terms of the kind of modes of representation is that when you arrive to the collages, which I think is a little bit later, you kind of rediscover or it seems like you understand anew how you're kind of recombining these elements and kind of framing and cutting, and the architecture is sort of abstracted and it's really the context that mm-hmm. Comes to life. And in particular, what I find interesting is the jump to the kind of quote-unquote preservation work, where suddenly the context becomes an existing building. Mm. And I found both the project with Theaster Gates, where, starting to take that building as your context and then deciding, what to erode and what to kind of close up is really powerful. And in particular, I think that with the Isozaki building, also reinstating the boundary in terms of kind of finding the essence is so when context becomes an existing building, the work is really incredibly powerful. And with the MCA, which is an unbelievably difficult building to tackle, I thought the kind of strategy of the base was kind of incredibly smart in terms of actually instating a wall, but actually that wall makes the building more accessible mm-hmm. and transparent. It's also with the Manil, the kind of inside and outside collapse finally. I mean, here you're not just framing, you're like literally sort of embedding. So the kind of question of context, and of course we, think a lot about architecture's engagement with an environment, but you're defining environment in a kind of maybe more traditional way, but in terms of the kind of literal inside and outside. But I think it's quite sort of fascinating in terms of how the architecture is, both kind of bounded and completely open at the same time. So I'm just kind of commenting a little bit on this question of context and the kind of outside in kind of force of the work, and if it's something that you're kind of finding, and how I'm thinking about climate and thinking, well, Chicago's cold, mm-hmm. But anyway, so if you wanted to talk, and finally, just in terms of another understanding of context, I thought it was really interesting when you mentioned that you were more interested in the city than the metropolis. So the city as form and formed, and a series of fragments, rather than the kind of unformed culture of congestion, right? So kind of the idea of the architecture as formed and part of a larger formed context is kind of quite powerful. Mm-hmm. I don't know, just my kind of initial response?
Well, there are many questions, but maybe I can address the first one. When you talked about apertures and windows and also the relationship to case study houses, mm-hmm. I think our interest in apertures and windows didn't start with something disciplinary. It started off with a very pragmatic approach, which is when we started our office, we came back from Switzerland and were used to extremely precise details and very mm-hmm. high construction costs. And I remember at that time, we were flipping through one of these compilation books of what happened the last few years. And I remember we could pick which is a European project versus an American project without reading the caption based on how thick the mullions are. And I think at the outset, we didn't want to be hijacked by Pella windows and storefront windows. So as a natural instinct is that we built the windows in, so there's a certain poche, that then we give the aperture back to the architecture. And speaking of context, certainly one also responds to one's architectural context. At that time, in the mid-late 90s, a lot of Los Angeles practices were really maybe doing a lot of focused research on patterns, and oftentimes windows or apertures basically became one of the ingredients of that pattern, And for us, that really relegates the window to a surface. Whereas for us, I think the window and the aperture has more to do with the massing mm-hmm. than the surface mm-hmm. itself. So on one hand, how we place a window has to do with the weight or lightness of the volume, or how we push the window to an edge versus centering it, like things like this, in terms of the gestalt of the mm-hmm. opening.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I mean, I think also the idea of context in the case of a single-family house. I mean, I think Mark and I, we on our team, we often, even as a relatively small singular object, spend a lot of energy trying to understand, sort of projecting a new reading of context mm-hmm. through the building. I mean, those sort of funny axonometric sort of urban plans of what how we could sort of rewrite that context. So there's a sort of deeper disciplinary question that we always strive for in the work that helps us sort of recreate a vision of the context. So it's not about contextual and always the literal sense. But I think one of the things that is happening, I mean, the bigger projects are newer projects, and so they're in a way less digested, but we're moving past some of the strategies of the smaller buildings, which are about mass and aperture, to more ideas about frame. And so sort of qualities of boundaries, of kind of continuity, programs are different, so we're employing ideas about void space that are both performative environmentally, mm-hmm. but give us a kind of flexibility and a porosity that sort of instills this lack of fixity that is something that sort of fascinates us, that you sort of captured in other ways in the work. We're always trying to find a kind of opposition or an oscillation, mm-hmm. something that resists being stable, mm-hmm. Not through, just through oftentimes just simply through opposition. And so I feel it's a new layer of our thinking that we're sort of excited to embark on.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think in the beginning, due to the nature of our commissions, the object seems to be what we were interested in at first. And Los Angeles is also perceived as a city made up of these desolate or isolated objects. And certainly, we think historically, there are also moments like this where someone like Shinko would look at objects. How do you organize with objects in larger spaces? Like, could the objects project a certain aura around mm-hmm. them? And as the scale of our projects begin to become slightly larger, and you can see sometimes we first try doubling the objects, agglomerating the objects, but up to a certain scale it ceases to be coherent. I think the Theaster Gates projects or the UCLA project, we begin to look at, for instance, the roof as something mm-hmm. as a unifying element. Mm-hmm. And I think the museums has we because of this existing fabric we went back into somehow this agglomeration to address it. Mm-hmm. But I think this issue of scale, as the projects become bigger, is something that we are dealing with. We also know, from people like Bota, you can't have an object and blow it up right. into much larger without that type mm-hmm. of mm-hmm. articulation. Mm-hmm. And the frame became something that very naturally evolved.
I think you can really see a continuity, actually, because mm-hmm. even in the kind of very small houses, the scale of the aperture mm-hmm. is you know, offset the smallness, mm-hmm. and now there's a kind of inversion, mm-hmm. a little bit, yeah. between the kind of between the scale of the aperture, yeah. and then the scale, yeah. of, so it does, yeah. become thinner as, yeah. as a sort of frame, but I really like the objectness, which then gets eroded, is actually what is enabling a lot of these adaptation projects, mm-hmm. to not only to become more legible, but actually to become, yeah. more open, mm-hmm. yeah. because, mm-hmm. you know, and I'm thinking both of the Isasaki and the MCA, which, mm-hmm. are so hard to, you know, you don't know where they start and where they end, so, yeah. they feel humongous, right, and inaccessible, yeah. and by basically reinstating the wall and creating kind of more intimate, mm-hmm. rooms, yeah. in the city, mm-hmm. you and I think that's working really quite, mm-hmm. quite powerfully. Since you mentioned pattern, I wanted, and I missed your MoMA talk about the flower pattern. You know, I was also curious about the sort of the kind of figures and the sort of play between inside and outside. That, in fact, do you want to say a few words about the kind of why you chose the Venturi Scott Brown flower patterns for your conversation at MoMA from the best store?
Yes, because it was there.
So context, it was there, yes, and context, so you took it as your object of study.
No, I think we were fascinated by Venturi. Mm-hmm. You know, I think, mm-hmm. we're Venturi for us. Well, we are fascinated by postmodernism. You know, I think we're not taking it as a wholesale, but I also think it was postmodernism was at its most important crest, maybe in our own education. But now I think with a critical distance, you can also see, mm-hmm. what are the blunders and what are the things that, for us, maybe should not be thrown out with the bathing water, mm-hmm. you know. And I think Venturi is someone who really, and Scott Brown, sorry, dealt with this notion of the ordinary. Mm-hmm. And I think within the ordinary, within the patterning, there's something that is very good that they do with planes and depth. Mm-hmm. You know, the number 4 or 5 station is for us really the model of spatial compression and depth, lightness and weight, everything happening, mm-hmm. together at the, mm-hmm. same time. You know, and for us, the best department store is something that happened before Herzog Demeron. Mm-hmm. You know, this kind of notion of the flower, mm-hmm. you know, and I thought that scale of dealing with somehow these kind of big box objects were very, mm-hmm. fascinating.
And, yeah. there is certainly a return, mm-hmm. of the, yeah. ordinary in terms of a kind of interest, a, mm-hmm. sort of anti-spectacular, mm-hmm. sort of approach. So since you mentioned, mm-hmm. Venturi Scott Brown, I wanted to, mm-hmm. maybe ask one last question before, yeah. opening it up. How do you collaborate? Mm-hmm. Because obviously we're seeing so many, mm-hmm. you know, again, a kind of generational, partnerships. And, you, yeah. know, I was curious if you wanted to kind of share some of the dynamic. Mm-hmm. Do you design together? Do you, mm-hmm. like, design separately?
No, I mean, I don't think there's really a hierarchy that way. I think that, I mean, part of perhaps our interest in collaboration and really taking it on with outside friends outside of our office is to sort of mitigate that, mm-hmm. that thing about the sort of partnership, mm-hmm. you know, that it's almost by bringing in more voices.
So you're
voices.
Not, yeah, you're not, yeah. in a kind of stranded island.
Yeah, yeah. yeah. or so I think that...
The curve will be this way.
No. And I think also, Amale, you mentioned, you brought up the issue of ordinary. And, mm-hmm. I think for us, we're not trying to pitch ordinary against ecstasy. I think for us, it always needs to be ecstasy, but it's a delivered... a delayed delivery of ecstasy that, mm-hmm. interests us more. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that's why Lowe's is a figure that interests, mm-hmm. us. When you talk about, like, what are the responsibilities within a city? We, mm-hmm. we like his notion of being very gentlemanly on the exterior, mm-hmm. as urban responsibility, where it's very perverse in the, mm-hmm. interior. You know, we thought somehow this perversity doesn't have to be...
So immediate.
Yeah. Immediate, yeah. Mm-hmm.
You're completely trying, no, avoiding my how do you work questions.
I think we work together, we design together. From the beginning, we also, it's not just us. All the work, right. is really a team of people, and some people in the office have been with us for 10 years. So we work very horizontally, and oftentimes, after the initial stage of the design project, one of us or one of our colleagues will take the lead. Mm-hmm. You know, and oftentimes that has to do with the dynamics with the team, with the client, how projects are distributed within the office and such.
But I think, just to further that, and maybe it's it's just the way we work, but perhaps it sort of offsets this partnership thing, which is, I think when we start, we have a very heavy schematic design phase, so there's sort of a lot of options on the table. And I think that partly isn't about not one, it's not to sort of denigrate or not deal with authorship, but I think it's just how we have to think. So I think it requires a team, and it sort of isn't, it's almost more about curating than about designing, like, this is my drawing, or whose idea was that.
Right.
But I also see, like, as the scale of the project begins to change, I also see this model needs to be somehow reworked. The reason is I think some of the earlier projects, so much effort is put into schematic design, but I think the longer we've been in practice, the more we realize that sometimes architecture doesn't arise in the schematic phase. Sometimes it's very fundamental. Sometimes it arises in design development, and oftentimes at CD, the flavor of the architecture comes out. And if one of us are not involved later on in the project, some of that aspect could be missed out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I know the feeling. What about the white? The kind of abstraction, right? Because so postmodernism, but white postmodernism, no yellow trace. So that yellow trace goes. That's quite powerful in terms of kind of unifying the work as well.
I think that's very much has to do with, we see white as maybe, or this kind of blankness or this abstraction as perhaps a veil of what happened in the interior. I think a lot of the projects that we are attracted to tends to have a quality of being slightly mysterious. Mm-hmm. They have something to say, but they're not too eager to scream at you. But if you give them attention and scrutiny, it unveils. Or maybe
it's as kind a of result, otherness.
Yeah, that I mean. So maybe as a result, that somehow translated into some of our work.
You're becoming less white.
Yeah. You're becoming less white?
Yeah. Red sandstone. Yeah.
Okay. Some questions in the audience? Besides applying for work for the students who are left. Some of them have already spent a summer, right?
Okay.
Hi.
One of the things that really fascinated me about your presentation was when you showed back-to-back the white space collage images and then the more quasi-realistic renderings. And what I found fascinating about that was the closeness to which the two resembled each other. It was almost as if that representation was just as real as the rendering. And my question to you is, to what extent, when you're designing, do you think about how the final images and the building will resemble the initial concept images?
Well, I mean, I think we think about that a lot. I mean, I appreciate your observation. I think that not maybe speaking more about the collages, not all of them are. I mean, they're sometimes made at different times. Sometimes they're in the phase of the design process. Sometimes they're made after. But I think what has been powerful for us about making those images, and I think it speaks to part of your observation, is that they're sort of incredibly difficult images to make. I mean, it takes a long time to make each one, as Greta can attest to, because it's really a sort of a lot of editing that has to happen, both in terms of how to describe the project itself and then how to understand the sort of, how to insert it into the suitable context to sort of tell the story that's been edited out in a way by the silhouette. And so I think it's both a kind of conceptual exercise to make those images, but I think it also helps us sort of distill our understanding of what, through the vagaries of design and construction, like what is the sort of essence of what a project is. And so I think it's a disciplinary effort as much as a representation.
Thank you.
Hi. One of the compositional strategies in the buildings, especially the houses, are these remarkable details that, if you look at them from one angle, appear to reflect a kind of vernacular element, like a pitched roof or an arch or something like that. But then if you shift your angle, you see that same geometry starting to misbehave and explore other possibilities and behave in different ways. And so somehow the same building can register as either, I don't know if it's postmodern versus hypermodern or vernacular versus transcendent, but it's very interesting that the same geometry can be read in these parallel but paradoxical ways. And I'm just wondering if that's a conscious strategy or what your thinking is there in terms of referencing, as I think you said with the drawing center, a geometry that can be vernacular if you need it to be, but it can also be something that's kind of independently generated by pure conditions of sight or structure or what have you. So are you post-postmodernists or are you post-post-postmodernists?
Well, I think that's a very interesting observation. I think there's a famous quote by Ed Ruscha that we always abide by, which is, he said that his whole life he wanted to achieve this effect of huh, wow, in his paintings. And somehow this huh, wow really stuck in our heads early on in our practice. And we understand it as a kind of defamiliarization as a prelude to cognition and ecstasy. You know, so in order to have defamiliarization, one has to built in familiarity. And I think maybe that's where the context, the vernacular comes in. You know, so in a way, maybe history, vernacular, the context, for us is a Trojan horse or something that is a prelude before something happens. You know, so I think unconsciously or consciously, when we start out with types, we start out with something, creates that type of familiarity so it's not so that strangeness could occur.
I have a question about the selection of images that you used for the collages, and what was the criteria for choosing the images, mm-hmm. the backgrounds?
Yeah. I think in the beginning, the first ones were Schumann, Julius Schumann. You know, there was a series of Schumann books that came out by Taschen all around the same time. We were doing projects in Southern California. For us, it captured a moment of Southern California, you know. So we started this Schumann series. I think later on, it turned into Mies. You know, there are a lot of Mies van der Rohe in the Miami project. We used the Neue National Gallery. In the Kauai House, we used the Barcelona Pavilion. Some are more obvious, and some we did some work, like we took out the Kobe sculpture, for example. But we also like this type of roughness, you know. On one hand, we try not to do anything digital except for moments like that. But we tend to like Xerox it in a very old-fashioned way many, many times that you see this type of roughness of the image. I think at the end, when we move into the Italian film, it just happens happenstance, really. You know, we always think of what is the best. When we did the Vault House, we thought, which is the best house ever in this context? And it's Casa Malaparte. And where do we find Malaparte images? We looked at Gunter Fork, not so nice. But Fellini, fantastic, you know? So naturally, I think that led into using the Bicycle Thief as another context. And it's also things we like, you know?
Did you have a question? Yeah.
Thanks for the inspiring talk. Maybe this is kind of like a reporting from the West question. So in the context of your interest in typology, and you talked about the two Aldos and everything, when you think about your practice happening in LA, how do you feel about you know, how LA was this kind of experimental, speculative place with the case study houses, and then also, you know, in the 90s and now, but How do you feel about your practice in the context of LA's, like what's happening today versus 10 or 20 years ago?
Today versus 10 or 20 years ago?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. 10 or 20 years ago.
What were we doing?
10 or 20 years ago.
Well, I guess you could also say, do you feel like you're sort of in the woods, so to speak, or do you feel like there's a like, how do you relate to the kind of local community of designers? And
well, I think the generation before us, maybe the one that were active 20 years ago, I'm thinking of Morphosis, I'm thinking of Eric Moss, I think we tip our hats to them because they really opened up the field, you know, to the next generation that comes. But I also feel that, it was a John Adams who said, whatever liberates you yesterday will seek to govern you tomorrow. And I also see that type of initial liberation, what was accepted as the other becomes the norm in the generation that follows. But I think what interests us in LA is a space that we never feel that LA gives us the pressure to be one direction or the other. You know, I think we exist maybe slightly outside of the general direction of what Amal mentioned as the LA school, but I think people are very generous and very supportive. I think this kind of distance between everyone, or the illusion of distance, given that Los Angeles right now is actually much denser than what it was before 10, 20 years ago, but when you're there, you still feel like you can have a barbecue everywhere. You know, there's so much open space, and I think that type of open space also projects into the profession, where you feel that you're not that competitive. You feel like you're competing with yourself or someone else, but you don't feel like you're always like fighting for the same project. You know, you feel like there are a lot of projects going on at the same time. So I think that the early generation actually blazed the trail for us to be open and embrace things that we think it's important.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, at the same time, I mean, just because I think what's interesting and what I've observed in many of the speakers that we've kind of had speak here, you know, you can be completely, a lot of the kind of strong, what I consider strong practices are both right now embedded in a kind of context, but also having a sort of conversation with many other people, you know, in
far away places.
Yeah, and you know, globally, without having to have a kind of global practice. It's more like you're engaged in this sort of conversation, even though you're totally embedded in a certain context. And I really see your practice as, you know, part of this kind of landscape of practices kind of increasingly emerging, but yet, yeah, of course, it does feel like you emerge out of LA and you have this kind of ease, but it's a kind of different context than a sort of a group that would be, you know, the LA school. Yeah.
I also think, I mean, perhaps differently than this previous generation that Mark talked about, we felt at a certain moment as our practice was growing that we just knew how difficult it was going to be to get a bigger project. I mean, I think the sort of culture of building, the sort of risk-averse culture of the U.S. was incredibly limiting to us. And so, you know, we were sort of radical about it. We stopped teaching, we went to Europe, and we didn't really show any of those projects tonight. But that gave us the chance to do some larger scale work that then allowed us to come back to America and be able to do the Manil and some of the other museum projects. And so I think there was also a sort of an intentional distancing as a way to sort of create opportunity to come home, to go east, and then be able to come back. And, you know, frankly, now we very few of our projects are in LA.
But we went out not because we are like the Spanish who are so powerful to go out and conquer. We're more like the Portuguese with no food at home, we have to go out and seek them.
Thanks. I have a question again about the collages, maybe. I always thought this was a very clever thing, which is you make the collage, and all you have to really do is replicate that one moment from the photo, and then the rest of the building, you can sort of do whatever you want and still be contextualized in history. I guess that's one way of thinking of it, but my question is, how far do you take the references, or how far is it inappropriate to take it too far, and sort of how do you draw that line?
I think that's a very good question for a few reasons. One is that you identify the aspect of the moment. And we sometimes talk with colleagues like, who are architects who do moments? Like Herzog Dameron for us are people who do moments very well. OMA does sequences very well. Like maybe Herzog Dameron looks much more photogenic, but when you get into OMA building, then it unfolds, you know? So I think it has to do, when you talk about moment, what the collage does, it represents this on a singular moment. I think for us, we, you know, the earlier question about the collages and building, you know, the generation before that generation was Frank Gehry, like whom we look to a lot in terms of, especially his early career. And we remember Gehry's always said in the beginning that he could never win competitions because he focused so much on the built building at the end. So I think in a way we also try to adopt that ethos early on. You know, we do very little representation or do a lot of complicated drawings that are not directed towards the built work. We are not very good in archiving everything, you know. And it's the collage is something that happened on the side. It just happened, and then there was some interest, and then we were invited to do a show. We did more, you know. So it wasn't something that we are actively producing. Sometimes it helps the design project, oftentimes not. But I think that the question that also interests me is that you talked about how important is the legibility of the source. And I think it relates back into the history of the issue of postmodernism. You know, I think the problem with postmodernism that we see, or which I shouldn't say the problem with everyone, but I think there was a period where people think that if you put a Palladian window on a mini mall, it increases the status, and that's not the case. You know, I think it's an act of association. You know, we're interested in history not as a way of wearing a badge of history, but we're interested in more subtle nuances of history. You know, I never would have thought about it, but I think maybe the earlier collages, the images are much more obvious where they're from, and then some of them later on are less obvious. Mm-hmm. But maybe it also goes back into Casimir de Kinsey's, like the idea of the model, you know, like how important is the model? We see it not that seriously, you know. For us, is we use Mies not because we want to equate with Mies, because you will always lose, you know. But for us, there's something that's captured in those images or representations that maybe we try to find in our mm-hmm. building.
All right, well, thank you so much.
Thank you.